Let me take you back in time, to a place without the wonders of the modern world. 500 years ago, the earth was dark, a place of mystery and superstition. But then science changed everything. This series will tell the stories of the British scientists who changed the world. We have asked some of the great scientists and inventors of today to tell us about their heroes.
Now let's start her up.
It opened up a whole new world of the very small.
Pete, was Thompson's big idea.
For me, Hunter is a true hero.
Exciting possibility.
He made science in Britain really matter.
Britain has a tremendous scientific legacy that most people know little about. We want to set the record straight and put science back on the map.
The world is full of wonders, but they become more wonderful when science looks at them.
Our story began in the 17th century, with a handful of men, who unlocked the puzzle of gravity. The next generation took science out into the world. They harnessed steam to kickstart the Industrial Revolution. Today, we want to tell you about their heirs, six men of ambition, who between them would use science to light up the world. Science had come of age.
The 19th century was the time to think big. Big machinery, big enterprises, and big ideas about energy, evolution, and engineering. The stage was set, the show could begin.
Imagine you were alive in 1800, and someone had offered you a ride in one of the newfangled hydrogen balloons. You'd have seen a country full of farms and fields. There were no railways. A letter would be carried by horseback. By day, the new steam engines would thunder, but when the sun went down, the country went dark. But all that was about to change.
On a spring day in 1813, a young man, just 21, walked down Albemarle Street in London to start a new job here at the Royal Institution.
His name was Michael Faraday, and if one man switched on the lights of the world, it was him. This is his portrait, captured through the new medium of photography. He was in his 50s when this was taken, an acknowledged leader of British science. But it had taken struggle and genius to get there.
Faraday was born into a poor family. His father was a blacksmith, and the young Michael was apprenticed at an early age to a bookbinder. This brought him into contact with scientific papers, and he became fascinated by science, particularly by electricity.
In the early 19th century, it was a mystery. They saw it in the sky above their heads. They even had crude batteries. But no one knew what it was, how it worked, or how to harness it in enough quantity for it to be useful. Faraday was determined to change all that.
Faraday's genius was his use of physical experiments to explain his scientific mind. And on the 3rd of September, 1821, he gathered together a few materials and made something that would have far-reaching effects. And this is my version of it.
There's a bowl of mercury, a magnet in the center, and a copper rod connected by a wire to a battery. When I connect the wire, you'll see the copper rod rotating around the magnet. Now what's happening is that there are magnetic forces down the magnet and also magnetic forces down the copper rod. And one repels the other, and so you get rotary motion. Now, it may not look like much, but this is the first electric motor.
What Faraday had done was make something extraordinary out of two things people took for granted. He had combined the chemical electrical current of the familiar battery with the powers of attraction and repulsion of the familiar magnet. The interaction of the magnet and the electricity created mechanical work in the form of the piece of wire spinning round and round. Faraday had shown us how to harness electricity to make a motor. Now what was really needed was a way of generating electricity without a battery. It took Faraday years to find one, but when he did, it looked simple.
Using just these, a magnet and a coil wrapped with wire, he was able to create magnetic induction, an electric current. As I move the magnet through the coil, I create an electric charge. In 1831, Faraday invented the first dynamo, and with it, changed our lives forever.
In his London workshop, Faraday had become the first person to harness the power of electricity, paving the way for turbines and power stations, cities with lighting and heating, powering everything from the TV you're watching to the life support machines monitoring human heartbeats. But it would take decades before Faraday's theoretical ideas would leave the laboratory and make an impact on the wider world.
One early application of Michael Faraday's work took place here at the South Foreland Lighthouse on the Kent coast.
The South Foreland Lighthouse had been built to provide a safe bearing for ships leaving or entering Dover, so they could avoid the Goodwin Sands 3 miles off.
Michael Faraday was asked to be an advisor to Trinity House, the body that supervised the country's lighthouses. He was convinced that electricity could be used to power the lamps, and he supervised the installation of an electromagnetic generator. In December 1858, South Foreland became the first lighthouse in the world to show an electric lamp.
Eventually, there was a chain of lighthouses around the country, beaming electric light, saving lives, and showing just what this great energy could do.
But it is a far cry from a generator that can power a single light to lighting up a whole city. And it would take the genius of other men to take Faraday's great discovery and find a way to make it power the world. In an era of big ideas, one idea towers above the others. Evolution. It explains how we gradually came into being, and how all living things are connected. One man is famous for this theory, Charles Darwin. But there is another man, always in history's shadow, who is also important. The Victorian naturalist, explorer and collector, Alfred Russel Wallace.